Sounded so fearfully affected that she was ashamed. is it about the marquis?
That's right, miss, said the tallest of the men, a lanky, freckled fellow, and he shifted his stool back, knocked back his straw hat, and smiled down at her. That's about it. His smile was so easy, so friendly, that Laura recovered. What nice eyes he had, small, but such a dark blue. And now she looked at the others. They were smiling. Businesslike, the Marquis. Well, what about the Lady Lawn? Would that do? And she pointed to the Lily Lawn with the hand that didn't hold the bread and butter. They turned, they stared in a direction. A little fat chap thrust out his under lip, and the tall fellow frowned. I don't fancy it, he said. Not conspicuous enough. See, with a thing like a marquee. And he turned to Laura in his easy way. You want to put it somewhere where it'll give you a bang slap in the eye if you follow me. Laura's upbringing made her wonder for a moment whether it was quite respectful of a workman to talk to her of bang slap in the eye, but she did quite follow him. Tennis court, she suggested, but the band's going to be in one corner. Going to have a band, are you? Said another of the workmen. He was pale. He had a haggard look as his dark eyes scanned the tennis court. What was he thinking? Only a very small band, said Laura gently. Perhaps he wouldn't mind so much if the band was quite small, but the tall fellow interrupted. Look here, miss, that's the place, against those trees over there. That'll do fine. Against the Caracas, then the Caraca trees would be hidden, and they were so lovely with their broad, gleaming leaves and their clusters of yellow fruit. They were like trees you imagine growing on a desert island, proud, solitary, lifting their leaves and fruits to the sun in a kind of silent splendor. Must they be hidden by a marquee? They must. Already the men had shouldered their staves and were making for the place. Only the tall fellow was left. He bent down, pinched a sprig of lavender, put his thumb and forefinger to his nose, and snuffed up the smell. When Laura saw that gesture, she forgot all about Caracas in her wonder at him caring for things like that. Caring for the smell of lavender. How many men that she knew would have done such a thing. Oh, how extraordinarily nice workmen were, she thought. Why couldn't she have workmen for friends rather than the silly boys she danced with and who came to Sunday night supper? She would get on so much better with men like these. It's all her fault, she decided, as the tall fellow drew something on the back of an envelope, something that was to be looped up or left to hang, of these absurd class distinctions. Well, for her part, she didn't feel them. Not a bit, not an ounce. Shall have enough cannibal. Jose, must say. Have one each, my dear, said cook in her comfortable voice. Your mama won't know. Oh, impossible. Fancy cream puffs so soon after breakfast. The very idea made one shudder. All the same, 2 minutes later, Jose and Laura were licking their fingers with that absorbed inward look that only comes from whipped cream. Let's go into the garden, out by the back way, suggested Laura. I want to see how the men are getting on with the Marquis. They're such awfully nice men. But the back door was blocked by cook Sadie, Godber's man and hands. Something had happened. Tuck, tuck, tuck. Clucked cook like an agitated hen. Sadie had her hand clapped to her cheek as though she had toothache. Hans' face was screwed up in the effort to understand. Only Gopper's man seemed to be enjoying himself. It was his story. What's the matter? What happened? There's been a horrible accident, said cook. A man killed. A man killed. Where? How? When? But Gopper's man wasn't going to have his story snatched from under his very nose. No, those little cottages just below here, miss. Know them. Of course she knew them. Well, there is a young chap living there, name of Scott, a carter. His horse sheet had a traction engine, corner of Hawk Street this morning, and he was thrown out on the back of his head, killed. Dead, Laura stared at Godber's man. Dead, when they picked him up, said Godber's man, with relish. They were taking the body home as I come up here, and he said to the cook, he left a wife and five little ones. Jose, come here. Laura caught hold of her sister's sleeve and dragged her through the kitchen to the other side of the green baize door. There she paused and leaned against it. Jose, she said, horrified. However, are we going to stop everything? Stop everything, Laura, cried Jose in astonishment. What do you mean? Stop the garden party, of course. Why did Jose pretend? But Jose was still more amazed. Stop the garden party. My dear Laura, don't be so absurd. Of course we can't do anything of that kind. Nobody expects us to. Don't be so extravagant. But we can't possibly have a garden party with a man dead just outside the front gate. That really was extravagant, for the little cottages were in a lane to themselves at the very bottom of a steep rise that led up to the house. has an accident, you'll lead a very strenuous life. I'm every bit as sorry about it as you. I feel just as sympathetic. Her eyes hardened. She looked at her sister just as she used to when they were little and fighting together. You won't bring a drunken workman back to life by being sentimental, she said softly. Drunk? Who said he was drunk? Laura turned furiously on Jose. She said just as they had used to say on those occasions. I'm going straight up to tell Mother. Do, dear, cooed Jose. I'm really not sure if her name is Jose, because Jose is more like a Spanish name. And, well, I don't think that the Sheridans would call their daughter Jose, so sorry for my mispronunciation. So, from now on, I'm gonna keep reading it as Joe's. Mother, can I come into your room? Laura turned the big glass doorknob. Of course, child. Why? What's the matter? What's given you such a color? And Mrs. Sheridan turned round from her dressing table. She was trying on a new hat. Mother! A man's been killed, began Laura. Not in the garden, interrupted her mother. No, no. Oh, what a fright you gave me, Mrs. Sheridan sighed with relief and took off a big hat and held it on her knees. But listen, Mother, said Laura. Breathless, half joking, she told her dreadful story. Of course we can't have our party, can we? She pleaded. The band and everybody arriving. They'd hear us, Mother. They're nearly neighbors. To Laura's astonishment, her mother behaved just like Joe's. It was harder to bear because she seemed amused. She refused to take Laura seriously. But my dear child, use your common sense. It's only by accident we've heard of it. If someone had died there normally, can't understand how they keep alive in those pokey little holes. We should still be having our party, shouldn't we? Laura had to say yes to that, but she felt it was all wrong. She sat down on her mother's sofa and pinched the cushion's frill. Mother, isn't it really terribly heartless of us? She asked. Darling, Mrs. Sheridan got up and came over to her, carrying the hat. Before Laura could stop her, she had popped it on. My child, said Mother, the hat is yours. It's made for you. It's much too young for me. I've never seen you look such a picture. Look at yourself. And she held up her hand mirror. But Mother, Laura began again. She couldn't look at herself. She turned aside. This time, Mrs. Sheridan lost patience, just as Joe's had done. You're being very absurd, Laura, she said coldly. People like that don't expect sacrifices from us. And it's not very sympathetic to spoil everybody's enjoyment, as you're doing now. I don't understand, said Laura, and she walked quickly out of the room into her own bedroom. There, quite by chance, the first thing she saw was this charming girl in the mirror, in her black hat trimmed with gold daisies and a long black velvet ribbon. Never had she imagined she could look like that. Is Mother right, she thought, was a mistake to have come. She knew all along it was a mistake. Should she go back even now? No, too late. This was the house. It must be. A dark knot of people stood outside. Beside the gate, an old woman with a crutch sat in a chair. Same, you had to grow. was getting anxious. Was it all right?
Yes, quite.
Oh, Laurie, she took his arm. She pressed up against him.
I see you're not crying, are you?
Asked her brother.
Laura shook her head.
She was.
Laurie put his arm around her shoulder.
Don't cry, he said in his warm, loving voice.
Was it awful?
No, sobbed Laura.
It was simply marvelous.
But Laurie, she stopped. She looked at her brother.
Isn't life, she stammered.
Isn't life.
But what life was, she couldn't explain.
No matter.
He quite understood.